Hello, a happy new month of March, and I hope you're marching into victory and success and manifesting all the nice things in your life. My name is Doreen Moral Moracha, the host of this amazing YouTube channel. So if you're new here, give me a like, subscribe to my YouTube channel, and if you are interested in matters HIV, you want to know what is happening in the HIV world, and basically you would just interested in my journey and my story as a person living with HIV, please don't forget to give me a subscribe, like, share, and leave a lovely comment in the comment section. So today I have some news for you, and I'm catching up on what has happened in the HIV response in the last few months. And I know that in the last few months I've really been bringing content that was from Lab Matters Kenya and from Y Plus Kenya, but now here we are and we are back. Okay, so if there is a video you want me to talk about, I know there's some few videos that have been requested and I am going to get into them. Okay, so don't worry, but first we start with an update. Apart from the fact that now I have a boyfriend, that is an important update. Okay, and my beads today, I bought these beads in Durban. They're inspired by my obsession of watching The Real Housewives of Durban. So yeah, you get it. If you don't get it, forget about it. So let's move on to the video. In the last few months, a few things have happened. I'm going to give you an update on the Dapivirine ring. I'm going to give you an update on the injectable prep and an update on the HIV cure, as well as the new HIV, not regimen. What is the name of that thing? The new HIV variant that was discovered in Netherlands. So let us start with my very favorite, which is the Dapivirine ring. The Dapivirine vaginal ring is a ring used to, I have done a video about this, you can check in the previous video, is a ring used to prevent HIV among HIV negative women. It's inserted in the vagina, stays there for 28 days, and it's laced with an ARV called Dapivirine. It only prevents vaginal HIV through vaginal sex. This ring has gotten a hitch. It has gotten a smaller bump in the journey, but it will come. So the ring experienced a few minor hitches, and when it comes to effectiveness, it's not that it was not effective, rather that the FDA felt it was not as effective as the current HIV prevention methods, where we have PrEP with a prevention level of up to 96%, condoms have 99%. So they feel like the effective level of the, like how effective it is, the percentage, you know, the way they say Dettol kills 99.99% of germs. Yeah, so that is what I mean. So they felt like it was not up to the standard, but as advocates, we're still advocating because we know that we have an issue, we have a gap, and that gap means preventing HIV, new HIV infections for women who are HIV negative, because they're the most susceptible that word, and the most at risk at well. So don't worry, ladies, we gotcha. We still are advocating that the Dapivirine vaginal ring is brought on board, and it's also, the good thing is Kenya has already adopted this as part of the treatment guidelines, so we're good. Okay, let us now go to the long-acting injectable PrEP. So what is PrEP? PrEP is pre-exposure prophylaxis. This is medication taken before a HIV exposure. Today, English words are just doing this. So it's taken before a HIV exposure, 7 days before, and it's taken for as long as you are exposed to HIV. Who are the people who are eligible to PrEP? People with more than one sexual partner. That in short means people in Nairobi. People who have are in discordant relationships, where one person is HIV positive, the other person is HIV negative, just like me and Mabu. But Mabu is not going to be using PrEP. I am undetectable for that reason. Okay. Anyway, sex workers, men who have sex with men, as well as anybody who just feels like, maybe if you're in a marriage and your partner has more than you as a sexual partner, you are eligible for PrEP. So that is what PrEP does. The current PrEP we have is on oral basis. That means it is a tablet. And you take this tablet for as long as you are exposed to HIV. But now the good scientists have come up with an injectable version of PrEP. What that means to us is it means that now the pill burden is going to be easier. When we say long-acting injectable, we mean the injectable, you get one injection the first month, second injection the second month, then after that, now you'll be coming in for 2 months injection, like just 2 months this time, 2 months next time, like that, okay? I hope you get my drift. Like, I'm trying to make it as simple as possible for everyone to understand where how the injection is administered. So after my bits look lovely, okay, anywho, after the injection is done, you are deemed prevented from HIV. However, you can always use other HIV prevention method. Like, it's not bad to use a combination prevention just to increase the effectiveness level of the prevention method that you have chosen. So you can use condoms while you're injected with PrEP. You can use, but you cannot go and use PEP. Like, in case you have like a condom bust, you can go and use PEP. But if your partner is undetectable, you can use that. It's called treatment as prevention. So when your partner is undetectable and you're also on PrEP, it means like you're now double, it's called double prevention. Okay, so that being said, we also have now the regimen for the injectable PrEP is called cabotegravir, or I like calling it Cabla, because it has lots of arrows and arrows, and I am not about to bite my tongue. So yeah, so the injectable PrEP is actually, even I think Kenya was part of the countries that were involved in the human trials, so that is a good thing, right? So we are hoping, we are believing that soon it's going to come. And I saw a misconception among media houses saying that we now have a HIV vaccine. Injectable PrEP is not a HIV vaccine. It is basically a HIV prevention method. A vaccine is a whole total thing, a whole new thing. But the vaccine also, I saw Moderna had come up with, they're doing human trials on a possible HIV vaccine. So let us wait and see. Maybe COVID is going to be our, what do they saying about the cloud silver lining? Yeah, so maybe COVID is going to be the silver lining of the HIV response. Okay, so moving on swiftly towards the HIV, I've spoken about the HIV vaccine, so you know there's a human trial going on, so we are waiting and hoping that, because especially in Africa, in sub-Saharan Africa, which has the highest burden of HIV, we do need a HIV prevention method that is very permanent, that is not PrEP or PEP, because when it comes to these other HIV prevention methods, sometimes there's the issue of access, there's the issue of them being available in at the hospital, there's the issue of eligibility. It is sometimes a little bit of a process. So let us hope for the vaccine, and hoping that Africa is going to be among the priority regions that are going to get the vaccine. So now let's go into the new HIV variant that was discovered in Netherlands. So apparently, according to scientists, it is more infectious. It mutates faster. It also is not a new variant. Apparently, it has been here for a while. It's just that it was not mutating as much, and then all of a sudden, scientists noticed that it mutated into a whole different variant, and that is why it was reported widely. So it's not something to be worried about, but it is something to be informed about. So I hope I've informed you about it and you know what it means in case you were lost. So now let us move to what you people like the most, the HIV cure. So what is happening in the HIV cure? With the HIV cure, the other day, this lady was declared cured for HIV, and everybody was tagging me on TikTok, on Twitter, on Facebook. It was crazy. But sadly, that is not a cure. The lady had leukemia. So let me take you a little bit back. There are only 3 people worldwide who have been potentially cured of HIV. When I say potentially cured, I mean that, like, the HIV has been in remission, in that they do not have to use ARVs for a while, and so it's basically the same thing. Okay, so they were considered potentially cured, but not cured. I know you will understand what I mean. Okay, so who are these people? One, we have the Mississippi baby. The Mississippi baby was born to a HIV positive mom. The Mississippi baby was put on treatment, and then the mother got lost in care. When we say lost in care, we mean the mother just almost, okay? And then when the mother came back 18 months later, the child was still, the HIV of the child had not mutated, the viral load had not gone high, nothing had happened. So that was it. They actually thought that the child might have the child system might have cleared the HIV on its own, but apparently it did not. Then we have the French teenager who has been had the longest HIV remission period ever. That is 12 years. However, the HIV came back, and the teen is currently on treatment. I don't think they're a teen anymore, because that was like in 2015. Okay, so then we have the French group. There was a group in France that was being researched on, that were also in remission for I think 7 years without being on ARVs, and also their HIV was not mutating, nothing was happening, the viral load was the same, and they also were one of the few miracles. However, they are now back to taking the ARVs. Then we come to the Berlin patient, who is the longest standing patient, who was stood like the longest, and was a science miracle. May his soul rest in peace, though. He had a type of cancer. I don't know whether it's lymphoma, but he got a stem cell transplant from a donor who has a HIV resistant cell, and because of that, his HIV cleared. We go to the London patient, who that happened in 2019. The London patient had lymphoma, got a stem cell transplant. A stem cell transplant is also a bone marrow transplant. So got a stem cell transplant, and because his donor as well belongs to the 10% population worldwide that cannot get HIV, and he basically also got cured. Okay, now let's go to the latest, which is the lady who just got, has been under HIV remission for the last 14 months. She has not used a ARVs. She had leukemia, got a stem cell transplant as well from her donor, and because her donor's cells did have the HIV resistant gene as well, she is now potentially cured. So what does all of these things mean? They mean that one day we will find a cure. They mean that maybe, because the 3 patients here giving us a pattern of stem cell transplant, there was a time when Israel as a country started research around the stem cell transplant. I do not know what happened about that. So maybe one day I'll try and follow up, but it kind of just like disappeared. I don't know what happened. So none of these are a cure. So the question is the stem cell transplant a HIV cure? No, it's not. Because I saw somebody even saying that I should open a GoFundMe to go and have a stem cell transplant. Well, I am not eligible for that because I do not have cancer. Okay? 1. 2, it is not for the masses, because it's not, it's painful and it's super expensive. And we know that some of the people living with HIV might never be able to afford it if it was made as a cure. And so it is not a cure, ideally. So what does this mean? It means that there is hope. It means that researchers are working, and it means that we are heading into the right direction. So let us hang in there. Let us not stop taking treatment until you go to hospital and they tell you now you are free of HIV. Please continue taking your treatment. Even if you're undetectable and you get a false negative result, you are still HIV positive. So let us hang in there, continue being undetectable, continue being amazing and awesome. And if you reach the very end of this video, please give me a like, don't forget to comment, share and subscribe, and I hope to see you next week with a brand new video. Bye bye.